have seen how Indian companies have started now stretching themselves. You have seen recently Torrent acquiring Elder, which was unheard of. A local company acquiring another local company. You will see more of that happening as we go forward. The pharma market has been projected to 54 billion. We never agreed with this figure. We never believed in this figure. But it's somewhere will end up around 40 to 45 billion, which is also pretty good. And if you look at how the growth rate would be around about 13 to 14% to touch about 50 billion. There's not much going to change in the TA categories. You will still have anti-diabetic growing at 22%. Your cardiac CVS growing at 18%. Anti-diabetic going from 6% to 10% of the entire market share, and cardiac increasing in market share for 14%. But anti-infective will still be a larger segment to play with, and that's area where you will see not too many new products coming, unfortunately, and therefore there would be a lot of competition for innovation in those areas. 2011, I have taken as a market as we move forward, is a patient consumer willing to pay. It started becoming brand conscious, but only 30% have access to medicines. The physicians have focusing more on urban and less in the rural areas. There is a cost consciousness on the part of physician because of the patient's pressure. Product and prices across tier categories differ, but more or less we are finding that unique products with differentiation command premium as compared to others. Private insurance have not played a big role. Whatever insurance we have seen in the government segment, in the Rashtriya Swasthya Bima, the coverage is very, very low and it's not going to get grown. The market is competition. The largest shareholder holds only about 7%. Too many players in the marketplace. Consolidation is must. We have seen two big consolidation happening. There are umpteen number of players below 100 crores that are looking for an exit. Umpteen number of players. There are umpteen number of players between 100 to 300 crores. They are looking for an honorable exit. And you will see all this happening as we move forward, that Indian companies will acquire some good assets going forward. Hospital market is going to be a big market. Focus on hospital market and try to build relationship as fast as you can. How do you look at 2020? Income levels are going to triple. They're going to be 600 million population who can afford medicines, I'm saying it. All the time you are saying that 30% cannot access medicines. Now here is a 300% will can afford medicine. There would be a growing awareness of the diseases. It will be not easier for a doctor. My friend Shashank is here. It's not going to be easier for a doctor to, you know, just put or prescribe a medicine to him without telling him why he's giving a particular medicine. A doctor will have to be actually more patient with his patients in coaching, counseling, and telling him the reasons behind his medications. And I think days will be go up where the 100% trust will be on doctors. Patients are going to challenge doctors and ask them, why are you prescribed this and why not this? And those are the questions doctors need to be answering it. And those doctors who answer all the questions to the patient will be more successful than those doctors who believe in just treating the patients. So mind you, there's a shift required from the physician side very badly. Product and pricing, commercial models, big brands, as you would see, now we have 200 crores, 4 brands, we have 100 crores, 40 brands. These big brands are going to be bigger and bigger. And the confidence of doctor would be more on the bigger brands. So it's a chicken egg story, but companies are going to focus on building brands. And brand building exercise will happen in a very big way, as you see it's happening in OTC product or FMCG products. Breadth of portfolio is very, very critical. But as I said, if you do not have portfolio in the critical chronic segment, and you are only focusing is in the anti-infective, and if you do not have focus on 3 or 4 TAs and you focus across TAs, probably you may still tag along, but you'll not be great company or great successful company in the top 10. So you need to decide how do you want to play it and where do you want to play it. Speciality therapies are going to grow. They are going to demand premium, and particularly personalized medicines, you will see it's happening. Targeted medicines are already taking place. A lot of personalized medicines will happen. Stem cell would be a critical role in the treatment. And I think this is a new trend that you will see emerging. The payer side, we are not seeing great coverage happening, but still almost about extend to 655. If the universal health coverage happened, as I was explained to you, it's not difficult to have a universal health coverage. We are experimenting one in a district in South. And if that success happens, then I think it's a great hope that the government will take it up as universal coverage in a big way. I think that's something that we need to be watch out for. If that happens, then there is going to be huge demand for hospitalization as well as the good medical care. Hospitals, I've already talked about, competitions between MNC and the Indian companies will disappear. There would be like everybody will compete with everybody. Because given the fact that most of the patented products will not hold patents, only about 3 to 4 patented products out of 10 will hold patents. So there would be huge competition from Indian companies on all the products. What's going to happen to Salesforce? There's a very interesting study which said that in 2009, you had about 100,000 Salesforce. It's expected to go to 350,000. God bless the doctors. The doctors are not growing at that rate. Now you're going to have a challenge here. If every company is going to focus their promotion through Salesforce, then the doctor's attention and time at the clinic is going to be a huge challenge. And I only hope that we don't go the China way. We stop all the field guys coming to doctor's clinic. Then you will see doctors, field people are, you know, lined up in doctor's residence in the middle of the night. So that possibility is going to be ruled out as we go forward, as more and more field force are coming in. And therefore, you have to think about a model which is a very balanced and mix between the field force and direct relationship doctors through media, through social, and through internet. I think that's something that one has to be working on. If the faster a company works it and drives, makes it a right balance, I think it will get a great success. The upper middle level, which is pharma spends, percentage of pharma spends about 21%, and global stivers are about 9%, and the below guys are at about 12%, are going to dramatically change as we move forward. And you actually, that 9% and 10% will be 37% population to be tackled. And therefore, the patient pool is going to dramatically increase at the same time. And therefore, the volumes of the pharma products are going to grow. The companies which are focusing more on volumes and price are definitely will get an edge as we move forward. There would be a scope both at the aspirers level, the seekers level. These two, 36 plus 37, will be an affordable population to be targeted by the pharma companies. Where is going to be focus, urban, rural focus? Everybody asks this question. I think urban will still be the big dominating force, irrespective of the fact. Because two reasons is, there is too urbanization happening now. Then the investment in rural taking place. Investment in rural taking place is giving more money in their pocket. So their purchasing power increasing, per capita income increasing it, but which is still lower than an urban per capita income, which is 200, urban is about 2,500 and rural would be around 600. So the buying capacity or paying capacity of the urban guy would be much larger than in rural. So not to say that you need to ignore rural, but all I'm saying is urban itself offers a great opportunity going forward. There are going to be change in the way the stakeholder is mapping or witnessing the shifts taking place. The pharmacist and physicians were the two with the links for a patient. That's going to change dramatically. And you will see the role of the physician is going to come down dramatically. And there are different roles and bodies that are going to take place. Insurance is not going to be a big key driver unless, as I said, universal health comes in, or unless from birth to death, the patient, any person buys, any person who comes to life during the birth is covered by the government, which is a proposal to the government that pay 50% of the insurance when a person is born, and the 50% the individual pays it, and make it compulsory for everybody to do it. Those below a certain level, government pays 100% up to a certain age. If that happens, you will see a dramatic change in insurance. Otherwise, it's not going to make much of a difference. To conclude, all I can say is that government is looking at various options. The options have not worked very fruitfully. Generic pharmacies have worked in some states. It has not worked in some other states. Generic prescription by doctors and governments had not been sustainable over a period of time. Free medicines has been tried out in Rajasthan. And I was chatting with somebody there, and it says to cover the BPL family, they need 300 crores for free medicine. Model that can be looked out. We've been now advising one of the political parties, they wanted to know what should be included in their manifesto on health front. And we said two things to them is what you need to look at health front is that how are you going to look at holistic way of managing a patient? It is not just treatment of the healthcare, but prevention also is very, very critical. and how do you build a model which is both preventive and treatment? And secondly, I said all that is required for our prevention, including the potable drinking water, should be made a part of the healthcare delivery. And this is a thought process which the government is now thinking about. The political parties, they wanted a concept paper has to build into the manifesto. So you have seen the political parties have also now started thinking differently and dramatically on delivery side. And you will see a lot of, after 2014, a maturity on part of the political parties on keep making their health as part of the manifesto and the forefront. And I think that's something very, very encouraging. There are going to be stringent approval required for new products, both for launching combinations or even for protocols for the purpose of clinical trials. So this country is going to be a big challenge. As it is, the clinical trials have moved out of India. It's almost zero. Two or three big delivery companies have even stopped functioning in this India country. Korea, which was a non-starter, has become a leading guy now. And all what things have happened just mainly because of our emotional attachment or because of activism taking place. But we have lost a great opportunity here. And I think it will take a while before we come back. So if we will have major challenges in both these areas in launching new products, in having India-based data for patented and proprietary products. I think it's a great loss to this country. We will not have it because they will not do trials in India. And that's going to be a huge challenge. Ethical marketing, as I said, is a way to go forward. Glaxo has shown a way. They need to implement it, walk the talk, and demonstrate in the marketplace. And you will see more and more companies who talk about it. It's high time that one of the leading Indian companies should talk about ethical marketing practices. I haven't heard a single Indian company standing up and says, from tomorrow, we will do ethical marketing practices. And by that, I mean very clearly is that we will not bribe doctors, we will not send refrigerators to their home, we will not give them cars, we will not send them on foreign trips, we will not give them on a payrolls. That's, if the moment that happens, then you will see that most of the companies will be working on the strength, promoting products on the profile of the products, and you will see competition becoming more and more healthier. This is the hope and belief that the future for the pharmaceutical industry is very bright, the environment eases out somewhat, and the GDP grows, so that 15% of growth that we are talking about becomes a reality. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Handa, for giving a very insightful presentation as usual. As a most visible face of the healthcare industry, he has been forefront of bringing the revolution. Could you ask a few questions if I could throw up onto the audience? Any questions, ladies and gentlemen, if you want to ask? Let us open up now. Okay, now let me ask a single question to you. Why did you leave Pfizer when Pfizer didn't want to leave you? I have sources close to me revealed to me that they didn't want to leave you, but you resigned. And why did you think of starting an outfit and take the risk of bringing Salus Lifecare into the picture when you were at the hot seat?
Great company, and I really cherish my term in Pfizer, and I think rest we should not discuss, because always you should leave a company with good memories and always talk good about a company all the time.
What is the future of looking at Salus Lifecare?
Well, Salus Lifecare, what we are looking at is we are looking at companies which are not being able to grow beyond a certain level, mainly because of the hierarchy, because of bandwidth, because of resources not available. We've been able to identify a few such targets, and we have been able to aggregate few such targets. And right now we are in talk with some private equity funds, and the moment it happens, it happens. So till it happens, it's still work in progress.
Congratulations, and wish you all the best to the visionary leader of Indian pharma industry.
Thank you.
Can I have the memento, please?
Thanks.
Ladies and gentlemen, the next speaker who is going to give the keynote address is the man who revolutionized India in homeopathic medicine. He's none other than Dr. Mukesh Batra. I can speak extempore, but I would like to read the lines. The moderator, Krishna Kumar, was supposed to be here, but there are some medical problems, that's why it didn't turn up. Dr. Mukesh Batra is a visionary entrepreneur, has deftly combined professional excellence and personal achievements with social commitment and contribution. Single-handedly, he has been responsible for pioneering the modern homeopathy in India and now abroad. Dr. Batra has not only set up a colossal corporate empire, but also extended the medical benefits of the safe and sure medical system throughout the country through path-breaking commercial as well as charitable initiatives. A prolific writer, he has authored several books on homeopathy, besides writing a regular weekly column on Hearing with Homeopathy in a leading newspaper, being a philanthropist. He has established Dr. Batra's Positive Health Foundation, being the social entrepreneur in 2001 to help the underprivileged and deprived sections of the society. The foundation has been making a profound difference to the lives of the street children and orphans, handicapped people and the elderly. Every clinic that Dr. Batra has adopted has a uniform practice of giving a very innovative model to the clinics over there. Dr. Mukesh Batra recently has forayed into the publications and has started a homeopathic and medicine for you. I think it is going to be the trend setting. I have the great pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, please give a huge round of applause for Dr. Mukesh Batra to come on the dais, please. Thank you very much, sir.
My dear friend Satya, organizers of this conference, dignitaries present, ladies and gentlemen. I'd first like to start with some of the challenges that we faced in a kind of a new vertical, homeopathy. My first Dharm Sankat, when I first started my practice in 1974, was how could I make money out of other people's miseries. A doctor was then considered to be a healer, a family physician, a friend, and sometimes even a matchmaker. We actually got people to say, you know so many people, why don't we get my daughter married? And, you know, talk to your patients who can do that. This was more in the case of homeopathy. It's the missionaries who brought homeopathy to India. You know, interestingly, homeopathy was discovered by a German doctor, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann, who was an MD and then converted to homeopathy. But it was brought in India through the court of Maharana Ranjit Singh. So it actually entered India through Punjab. And he had a sore throat, and a homeopathic medicine called Nalka Mara was